بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين إن شاء الله today we'll talk about the biographies of some of the imams of أهل الحديث we already talked last week about the imam Al-Bukhari, about the hadith of Imam Al-Bukhari. Okay, did we talk about his life or just...
No.
So today, inshallah, we talk about Imam Bukhari and then we'll move to Imam
Muslim
and other compilers of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, Imam Al-Bukhari هو أبو عبد الله محمد ابن إسماعيل ابن إبراهيم ابن المغيرة ابن بردزابة الجعفي المولهم الفارسي. Now what does this mean? This is not chain of narrators. This is chain of the
Of the ancestor of
Sheikh Imam Al-Bukhari. Now, he said he is Abu Abdullah. Abu Abdullah, this is his nickname. طيب? And maybe he has a son, his name Abdullah. And sometimes you see for the Arabs and the Muslim in general, because kunya is good. Kunya is one of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That a Muslim has a kunya. What's mean kunya? It's like the nickname. But the kunya or the nickname for the Muslim should be nice and has a meaning. Therefore, sometimes, especially among the Arabs, what they do, they give nickname for the son by his father. And the same thing also for the father by his son. What does this mean? For example, if your name is Ibrahim, right? And your father, his name, Abdullah. You're still young, like in high school or even elementary school, a child or adolescent or young man. So he didn't get married yet. So they call you Abu? Abu Abdullah. Abu Abdullah. Who's Abdullah? Is your father?
His father.
Okay, but Abu Abdullah. So this is kunya. Right? When this man get married and he has a son, most people they give the name of their firstborn, the name of their father. Some they don't. So if he give another name, then the nickname will be changed to his son. Now, for example, he has a son and he call him Hassan, then we'll call him Abu Hassan. Abu Hassan. The same thing also for whom? For lady. Mother. Naam. Mother of Fatima, mother of Hassan, mother of Ali, mother of Khalid. Depends on the name of her son. Naam. Or her father. So this is the practice. So what's the nickname of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Abu al-Qasim. Abu al-Qasim. His first born, his name is Al-Qasim, so he was, nicknamed as Abu Al-Qasim. And sometimes even the hadith, the Sahaba, when they speak about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they always, they talk about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Awsani Khalili Abu Al-Qasim. Naam, my beloved one, Abu Al-Qasim, advised me. So, so this is what the meaning of kunya. Sometimes among the Muslims, some kunya take the kunya of famous persons. Like for example, Ibrahim. Anyone whose name is Ibrahim, they call him
Abu Khalil.
Abu Khalil. Abu Khalil. Why? Because the Khalil is the title of Ibrahim, Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Right? Or sometimes call him Abu Ismail. Man, his name is إسحاق يكون أبو يعقوب. نعم. This is just it depends from you know one culture to another. But generally the Muslims they like the what they call it the كنية. So كنية الإمام البخاري أبو عبد الله بن. The word بن that means son. Huh? نعم. Even sometimes, and I think I'm not sure if this come from Arabic or not. Like in English, especially Hebrew names, they will find the word name. I mean, Ben David, Ben. See, anyway, here we talk about the Muslim culture. Ben, that means the son of. So sometimes when you read about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, "Huwa Muhammad ibn Abdullah, ibn Abdul Muttalib, son." Of Abdullah, son of Abdul Muttalib. And the Muslims, they care about keeping their trees, the family trees. Why? It's very important, especially for the close family. Why? Because the Muslim should take good care of his kinship. This is silat rahim. Silat rahim. And the more closer to you is those relatives from your father's side, more than your mother's side. I'm very surprised. The brother of your father is more closer to you than the brother of your mother. Why? Because the original is the father, the seed of the father. Naam? The mother is like a farm. That the father, he put the seed and then he come. Naam? This is why the You remember when you talk, you study this in inheritance. Al-Asaba, Asabat al-Rajul. Those, the supporters, you see the old stronghold of the man is whom? Huh? The family from his father side. Tayyib, the father side. This is why they keep the names. So from this, you can know the name of your relatives, your cousins. Because my dear brothers, there is certain rights that should be given to Ahl Salat al-Rahim, which is the kinship, your relatives. Even the Quran in many verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained on us to be nice and kind and take good care of our relatives. Right? So this is why the meaning bin. This is why they keep this. So you note that Al-Bukhari originally is not Arab, same like for Imam Muslim. And this, my dear brothers, to show you that this religion, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it doesn't depend on any race. Huh? It depends on whom? Sincere person, no matter what is his background. So sometimes you find many times you find some Muslim who served Islam, many of them they are not Arabs. In fact, throughout history, you'll find many of the heroes, they're not from Arabs. Therefore, always when we talk, my dear brothers, we talk about Islamic history, Islamic civilization, Islamic heritage, always we don't refer or mention the race. Why? Because there is no racism in Islam. No racism in Islam. Have you ever read in any of the Muslim literature that said black Muslim, white Muslim? Huh? Never. Naam? Always just Muslim. It's not like they said black American, white American, Hispanic, all these. In Islamic culture, this is not used. Why? Because Islam came to, and set one standard. The best among you is whom? Who? Huh? A taqwa. The one who is best in taqwa and piety. Pious person. And this is something that you can achieve. Naam? You don't choose your color.
You didn't choose your background to be Filipino or Arab or African. You didn't choose anything of your character. But you can choose your deed or not. This is the justice of Allah Azza wa Jal. So you are the one that you can be good and super, or you are the one that you can throw your soul and mischief and then will be bad. Allah Azza wa Jal is just. So He doesn't judge you because of your color, of your race, of your country or land or any of these things. Why? Because you have no choice in these matters. But you have choice to be good or not. Na'am? So this is why many of the ulama of Islam, in fact, they are not from Arabs. Many throughout history. In fact, the Arabs, now if you compare them to the population, the Muslim, they be maybe 8%. Only 8% or maybe maximum 10% of the Muslim population. Throughout history, if you read about heroes like Salah al-Din, Salah al-Din was Kurdi. Was from Kurd. He's not an Arab. Look to the Uthmani, who ruled the Muslim world for 500 years. They protected the Muslims through 500 years. They are not Arabs. They are Turk. See? So, this, my dear brothers, give us motivation that this is the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal said in the Quran, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدَلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُوا أَمْثَالُكُمْ. If you turn back, this will not, you know, hurt anything or change anything in the religion of Allah. If you turn back, Allah will replace other people other than you, and they will not be like you. That means they take care. They, they be dedicated to the deen of Allah. Sacrifice for the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. And this, my dear brothers, give us motive that the most important thing is what? To do our best to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and serve the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. And we are sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us reward in full. And the more you are doing good, getting near to Allah Azza wa Jal, the more you have success in this world and in the hereafter. Doesn't matter. So look at this, mashallah, Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, rahimahullah. All Muslim ummah depend on his book. Subhanallah. This is a sign, you know, this is ayah to show you the greatness of this deen. طيب. So he, Farisi, Muhammad Al-Farisi. طيب. Thus, the origin go back to Persia. So he is Persian. And Persia, in fact, which is now, part of it is Iran. In fact, they were Sunnah. They were Sunnah. But then the Safawiyin, group of Safawi, which are Shia, they came and they took control over this area. And then they forced people to be Shia, but originally this country was Sunnah. Naam? Right. However, his ancestral family were either slaves to the tribe of called Al-Ja'fi or protected by the tribe. Why he said either or? Because he said it is Mawla. Al-Imam Bukhari, Mawla. What does it mean, Mawla? Mawla, in the Arabic culture, it takes two meanings. Mawla is a person who was a slave and he was freed by his master. So he is loyal for his master, the one who gave him his freedom. Naam, like Zayd ibn Haritha. Naam, Zayd ibn Haritha, Mawla Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the Prophet alayhi wa sallam is the one who gave him his freedom, was a slave. Khadija radiallahu anha, she bought him, get him, and she gave him to the Prophet ﷺ before he become, he was sent by the message. So, and then the Prophet ﷺ gave him his freedom. So he mawla Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this one, other meaning for mawla is protector. That's, among the Arabs before, tribes, there are sometimes fightings. So what they do if there's somebody who is weak or he ran away from his own tribe because there's internal problems and he was afraid that he will be killed. So he ran and go and take protection with other tribe. So they call him, this is also Mawla, right? Because he wali, that means he get their protection. So the Sheikh here mentioned, he said either or, because it's not sure, was Imam al-Bukhari, he was a slave and then he was given his freedom, or he was called Mawla for this tribe because he was, you know, aligned or depend on them for his protection at that time. He was born in the month of Shawwal in the year 194. 194. That means he is in the first century. He was born in the first century. And this, the second century.
194.
Second century. And century is 100 years. And this century is among the three best centuries which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned in the hadith when he said, خَيْرُ الْقُرُونَ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلَوْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلَوْنَهُمْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the best of all centuries or generations, which is 100 years here, my generation, and then the next one, and then the next one. And the ulama said, this refers to the first 300 years of Islam. This is the best. This is the best. And most of the bid'ah, most of the innovation, in fact, started after these three great centuries. Like bid'ah al-mawlid. You know, mawlid now that people, some people celebrate mawlid. This mawlid was in the fourth century. It started, not in the beginning. And there are many other innovations. He started and he grew up as an orphan with his mother. Look, subhanAllah, to salam. We learn from the background of those great men. He, Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, was an orphan. SubhanAllah. And if you look, many of the SubhanAllah, the Muslim heroes or scholars, if you look at their background, you will find among them orphans. Now, what lesson you learn from this? Huh? What lesson that you learn when you see great people, in fact, they were orphans, like our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. See? This, my dear brother, to show you that the one who takes good care of us, of you, is not your father or mother. They are means. They are means. Naam. But the real protector, the real giver, the real sustainer, the real one who takes good care of us, Allah Azza wa Jal. This is why sometimes maybe the father died and he is righteous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take care of his offspring. That even the ulama said that the righteous man, the righteous man, the blessing reach him and reach his, you know, his offspring up till six generations. Like in Surah Al-Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about this man. وَأَمَّا الْجِدَارُ فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ وَكَانَ تَحْتَهُ كَنْزٌ لَهُمَا وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. And about the wall which Al-Khidr and Musa alayhi salam, Al-Khidr, they fixed it and they rebuild it again. He explained why he rebuilt it. He said this wall is belong to two orphans. They are living in the city, but this is their town. And under this wall there is treasure which was left for them by their father. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to protect them, commanded Al-Khidr and Musa alayhi salam to rebuild it. Why? They're still young. Ghulamain, still youth. So they, when they grow up, they come and they found them. The ulama said, the father or the righteous father that this ayah refers is their sixth grandfather. Sixth grandfather. Yeah. Why? Because he was righteous. So, this is very, very important. So it's not a matter of the presence of the father and the mother. It's for sure, it's very important. We don't say that it's not important. It's very important. The father give good example for his children. But also the most important thing is also the mother. The mother. So Imam Bukhari, his mother raised him as a righteous child from the beginning. So even he was an orphan now, he is the most famous one in the area of the ilm al-hadith. Right? And he grew up and as an orphan with his mother, he started traveling to search for a hadith in the year 210. That means he was 16 years old from the beginning. You know, not like our young generation now, they travel for Hollywood, for someone doing it with pleasure, for they go to, you know, we don't say that, don't go and travel and see this nice thing. But the most important was, what is your goal in this world, in this life? This, my dear brother, every one of us should have goal and should put in the mind of his children a noble goal that he concentrate on and try to work for it. And the most important noble goal is what? Getting the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal and serve the religion, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he traveled. Before, my dear brothers, the ulama, they call it al-rihlatu fi talab al-ilm. Al-rihlatu fi talab al-ilm. Journey for the sake of seeking knowledge. If you look and read about the history, the life, the biographies of most of our ulama, you will find many of them, they traveled from one place to another just for searching for ilm, for knowledge. And nowadays, we have classes, and we have cars, and it's very, alhamdulillah, mashallah, nice place, and people are sleeping or they are wasting their time. They don't even dare to go and attend classes which is available. And this is, you know, you are, inshallah, blessed by Allah Azza wa Jal. You are chosen by Allah Azza wa Jal. Those who attend and those who cannot attend, at least follow, you know, and try get benefit from this new technology by following classes, lessons through this, what they call it, social media. So we keep seeking knowledge. So Al-Bukhari, Imam Al-Bukhari traveled to collect the hadith. Why? Why he traveled? Because the Sahaba after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they were scattered in different places. The Sahaba after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam passed away, they traveled. Some of them, they inhabited where? In Iraq, some of them in Syria, some of them in Egypt, some in Yemen. Why? Are they going doing trading? No. To spread the message, to spread the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the teaching, the hadith. So the ulama at that time, you'll find many of the ulama, especially in the hadith, muhaddithin, they travel everywhere. They traveled, you know, Iraq, especially Iraq, Syria, Egypt, and Yemen. Why? Because they try to meet anyone who has one hadith. Look at this story about Imam Ahmad and Yahya ibn Ma'in. How much they care about the sincerity, the intention. They heard about one man in Yemen, one alim, that he knows many of the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So they plan to travel to meet with him. So they said, we'll go to, in our way, to Mecca and perform Hajj. And after Hajj, we go to Al-Yaman. When they come to Hajj, they found him in Mecca. So what they did, they hold him and they said, no, we came here for Hajj, but let him when he go back home and we'll follow him. To show you how much they care about, you know, the sincerity of their hearts, and also they count the steps, the time, the effort they spend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they know that Allah Azza wa Jal will count all this for them. And maybe they trouble for just to hear one hadith. And I'm saying this, my dear brothers, to encourage us about the importance, you know, of seeking knowledge. طيب. So he went to Hijaz, and Hijaz is this area. Hijaz is the western part of Arabia called Al-Hijaz. It's come including, you know, Mecca, Medina, Taif, and go down near Yemen, before Yemen, you know, like after Taif. This is called Al-Hijaz. Taif, the area of Al-Hijaz. And stayed there for 6 years. And then he went on Al-Sham. And Sham, this is the region, it was called Al-Sham, which include nowadays what? Jordan, Syria, Palestine, and Lebanon. These are all called Al-Sham. And this division between this country was made by whom? By the Crusaders, huh? Western colonies, because they want to cut the Muslim, you know, the Muslim Ummah to pieces, so they cannot be united. So they make this division and these borders. Right. And then he went to Misr. Misr, Egypt. And Al-Jazeera. Al-Jazeera, which is the Gulf nowadays. They call it the Gulf. Huh? The Gulf states. Including Kuwait, Emirates, you know, Bahrain, all this, Qatar, all this called at that time the area of Al-Jazeera. Now, Al-Basra, Al-Kufa, and Baghdad. These the main cities at that time were in Iraq. And these are cities where many scholars there. Al-Imam al-Bukhari had a very strong memory. Very strong memory. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Azza wa Jal, he blessed him with this memory to, you know, to serve his deen. But he used this memory in something which is beneficial. Now we find some people, Allah Azza wa Jal gave them talent, but unfortunately they don't use this talent in the right way. Some people, Allah Azza wa Jal gave them very, you know, a beautiful voice. Instead of used it in Quran, huh? Or Adhan, they used it in what? Singing or any of these things, you know? So some people, Allah Azza wa Jal gave them memories, good memories, but instead of keep it in memorizing the Hadith, the Quran, or a beneficial knowledge of any type, they in fact fill this memory, this storage of names, huh? Of sport players, actors, huh? Or any of these names. So the Muslim should be aware that any blessing that Allah Azza wa Jal gave it to him, that he should invest it where? Huh? Invest it in something that get him closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the way of shukr. This is the right way to shukr al-ni'mah, to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. It has been reported that he could memorize a book in just a single glance. He says, just look and memorize it. And this is not strange. It said that Imam al-Shafi'i, that when he read, he covered the other page just to concentrate on one. Because if you look, he memorized both of them. Allahu a'lam, is this exaggeration or not? But to show you that, you know, the blessing of Allah Azza wa Jal, my dear brothers, always with the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal said what? In the Quran. Huh? La in shakartum. What does it mean? Huh? When you give thanks, Allah will give you more. Give thanks for what? Any ni'mah. Now some people, all the ni'mah that they think about it is the ni'mah that go to their stomach. Some people, they say, alhamdulillah, our ni'mah. We have food, we have drink. It's the only ni'mah. The most important ni'mah that Allah give you is what? The ni'mah of iman and the ni'mah of علم علم علم, my dear brother, is the most important thing. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Allah azza wa jalla command him to ask more, he didn't say وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي مَالًا وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي جِسْمًا وَقُلْ, no, no. Allah azza wa jalla did not say, oh my Lord, increase me in money, huh? Or in treasure, or in beauty, or قال سبحانه وتعالى وقل ربي زدني علما. Oh my Lord, increase me in knowledge. What does this mean? This is to show you, my dear brothers, that the most important thing, in fact, is knowledge. This is why you are blessed here, because you are studying. While there are many people who are wasting their times, huh? You save this time for the pleasure of Allah, for Allah Azza wa Jal, to increase your knowledge. And also you have duties. What knowledge that we learn, you should what? Pass it to others and share it with others. This is the zakah of the ilm. The zakah of the ilm. And I just remind myself and remind you all to correct our niyyah, intention, that we try to learn this knowledge to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to call people to the way of Allah azza wa jal, to spread the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to keep our Muslim brothers and sisters and our community are informed about the real knowledge of the deen which come from the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have a light. When you have knowledge, you have a light. This is why you can see your way. But the one without knowledge, he's in the darkness. This is why most of this innovations and bid'ah, you'll find it among whom? Among ignorant people. Ignorant people. طيب. So, he was zahid. He abstained from the worldly things. This is called az-zuhd. Naam? Az-zuhd. Zuhd from zahada. Zahada, that means he doesn't have that much interest in this world. In fact, why? And this, by the way, the case of many of the Muslim scholars and Muslim ulama and people of knowledge. Okay. We'll stop just to hear that and then we can do it. طيب الزهد والورع في كلمتان, these two words maybe you need to know this, just you know, for your information till, and some of the Islamic tab that you'll find it sometimes in Islamic traditions. Zuhud from Zahada, وَهُوَ Zahid, the one who, you know, left this world behind him, and all his interest is in the hereafter. طيب طيب, what's the ruling of this? In fact, my dear brothers, this is very important. Islam, Deen al-Wasat, Wasatiyya, that means in the middle. It's not, because the Muslim should not just leave this world. قال سبحانه وتعالى وَابْتَغِي فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. نعم, وَابْتَغِي فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. This is سورة talking about Qarun. And seek the hereafter with whatever Allah gave you, but don't forget your share in this world. So the main purpose is where? The hereafter. But not to the point that you forget your share in this world. So the Muslim in this world, he should live this world, but live it according to the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah doesn't tell you, don't eat, you know, nice food, don't drink, don't ride a luxury car, don't live in a palace. No. As long as it's come from halal sources, it's not excessive, no israf, waste, then it's okay. The important thing is that you give shukr and thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the ulama before, many of them, they leave this. Why? Because they feel that, you know, if they involve more in this worldly affair, this will take them away from their task of seeking knowledge, of studying, of writing books, نعم, of benefit Muslims. So this is why the main. طيب, والورع. الورع, it's taqwa, piety, but more than this. الورع, that means he leaves something which is okay just because if there is possibility that it's not permissible. الورع, using something which is halal but just because I have very slight doubt, so we leave whatever he have even slight doubt about anything. نعم طيب. فكان زاهدا ورعا, which is mean the highest stage of taqwa, and he also stayed away from the rulers and sultan. Now, what does it mean stay away? He doesn't mix with people of authority, because if he was always close to the ruler or the sultan or the president or whoever in power, that means he will be affected by them, by power. You know, they are busy. So this will maybe keep him away from concentrating on knowledge. And most of the ulama, in fact, at that time, they try their best to stay away from the people of authority. Why? Because their heart for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maybe they will see all this luxury life, it may affect their life. Or maybe they will not be able, they see something which is, you know, not correct, and they cannot say it. Or they cannot give advice sometimes. So, and after, he was brave, courageous, and generous, and all the scholars in his time and after him praise him. All scholars till today, and all of us, we praised Imam al-Bukhari. And this, my dear brothers, inshallah, it is sign of acceptance. Sign of acceptance. What does it mean? When you find one person that many people love him, and then talk positively about him, and praise him, okay? That means, especially good and righteous people, that's inshallah sign that Allah Azza wa Jalla is pleased with this person. And some of the Sahaba, they were afraid. They don't like anybody to praise them. They're afraid that maybe this will, you know, take some of their hasanat. The Prophet ﷺ, you know, to tell them, they ask, "O Prophet of Allah, sometimes a man, he will be praised by other people." What the Prophet ﷺ said? Said, "Tilka ajilu bushra al-mu'min." This is, the past, you know, the nearest glad tidings which was given to the Muslim. So take it as glad tidings. But the important thing, my dear brothers, that we should not depend on this. If you find people praise you for any reason, especially if you are serving the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should fear Allah azza wa jalla. And be careful, because this heart may be affected by this world. And then man will think about him, "Yeah, I'm good. I am scholar. I am famous. I am wal'iyadu billah." And then will change the intention and purity of the heart, which may make your, you know, action was, is not sincere for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. And turn the heart, instead of trying to please Allah Azza wa Jal, try to please the people and take their praise and their word. Now, طيب الإمام أحمد بن حنبل رحمة الله عليه said, Khurasan has not brought out of it the like of Muhammad ibn Ismail. The land of Khurasan, which is beyond the Persia, never come or brought one like him. That means this is praising for him. That he's unique. Out of his like, طيب. Ibn Khuzaymah, rahmatullahi alayh, said, "I have not seen under the sky anyone having more knowledge and better memory of the hadith of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than Muhammad ibn Ismail." Look to this shahada, testimony. Imam ibn Khuzaymah, one of the ulama of the Islam, he said, no one memorized and know the hadith after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's the first for sure, after him no one memorized the hadith like Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi. He was mujtahid in his fiqh and has a strange way of extracting rulings from a hadith and indeed. So Imam al-Bukhari is not only compiler of the hadith. Some people, they think that all what he did is just collect hadith from here, from there, and he compiled it and put it in a book. No. He was also faqih. He was faqih. Al-fuqaha. He was a scholar. You see? And because he's a scholar, he was describing, you know, distracting some rules from the hadith that he read. He gave the hadith and he maybe this, you know, refers to this. Na'am. Or we can take this hadith as dalil, as proof for this ruling or that ruling, you know. So this is what the Shaykh is saying here. طيب. Mujtahid ijtihad, from ijtihad, he died. His book and biography testify to this fact. Now, he died in Khortak, a village about 6 miles from Samarkand, capital of Uzbekistan right now. And he left behind him a vast amount of knowledge in his book. May Allah Azza wa Jal have mercy upon him and reward him for whatever he did for Islam. So may Allah, my dear brothers, when we in fact read about those great scholars, this should encourage us and think about our children. These are the examples that we should put for ourselves and for our children, that we try our best to follow their footsteps. So we'll stop here inshallah, and next week we'll study about Imam Muslim rahmatullah, about the sahih of Imam Muslim, and then about the biography of Imam Muslim. Any question?
The time
he was born in the year 194, right? Okay, so he was in the Abbasi. Yeah, because al-Khilafah al-Amawiyya, after the four Khulafa, which is end about in the year 35, started Khilafat Bani Umayyah, which last about 90 years, and then come خلافة بني العباس العباسية the beginning of this خلافة. نعم. طيب. So we'll stop here. Inshallah, we'll go to prayer, and inshallah, we'll come back for salat after salat for the fiqh class. طيب. Remember, I also remind you about the class of fiqh. As we said, we started a new batch, inshallah, in GDC. So I encourage you to attend, and please share whatever you watch. Alhamdulillah, made it easy for us to broadcast this for our brothers and sisters who cannot attend this class because they are far away. But I encourage brothers who are in Jeddah and they are not engaged in any activity like some of the da'i of you are engaged in some activity, may Allah help you, to attend the class. Encourage others to attend these classes. It's not enough to watch through Facebook or any other social media. Why? Because when you come, every step that you walk, every minute that you spend, this gathering that we have, inshallah, it will be surrounded by angels by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is ibadah. In fact, this is one of the highest types of ibadah. And sharing knowledge, charity. So you share this also with others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in deen and ilm. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Barakallahu alayhi wa sallam.